Software engineers who have a significant amount of experience, say senior level or higher, often have a design interview as part of their overall interview loop. A good design often takes weeks or months to put together and involves dozens of people. So how can you possibly evaluate somebody for a design interview in just 30 minutes? Hi, I'm John L. Miller, the deliberate engineer. I've spent the last 40 years coding and 30 of those working at big companies like Amazon, Microsoft, and Google. I performed hundreds of interviews in that time, and I've been interviewed myself dozens of times. In this video, we're going to discuss the design portion of software engineer interviews. First, a disclaimer. I mentioned that I've given hundreds of interviews, but in terms of design interviews, I've only given a few dozen of those, and I've only received maybe a dozen myself. In other words, I'm not an expert on this, but since they're relatively rare, I suspect most of the other people who deliver design interviews also aren't experts. So the information that I give you in this video should hopefully prove useful. One differentiator between junior and senior programmer hires is the amount of design that they're expected to do and the amount of experience they're expected to have in that arena. As I mentioned earlier, 30 minutes really isn't enough time to do a design. Instead, what the interviewer will do is try and spot check different attributes relevant to working on big designs. For example, how good are they at collaborating? Can they break a very big problem down into smaller problems? And so on. Being able to determine whether somebody's a good designer from this sort of interview is a fuzzy inference at best. This is one of the few interviews where a lack of information on the interviewer's part may mean that they give a hire rather than a no hire. When the interviewer works well and delivers good information, it can help show whether a candidate is able to perform large-scale system designs, whether they're good at resolving the ambiguity in those systems, being able to divide up the chunks of work, figure out all the components that need to be done, without necessarily having deep information on each of those components. More junior developers who get a design interview might be asked to design something much smaller. For example, a simple class hierarchy relating objects to each other, shapes such as triangle, circle, and so on. More typically, a senior developer will be given larger total system design problems, which involve a variety of different systems working together and a variety of different types of components. For the rest of this video, we'll be focusing on the larger design problems. When an interviewer prepares to give a design interview, first they need to pick an area for that design interview. Typically, they'll take a look and familiarize themselves with the experience of the candidate, and then take a look at the cross-section of that candidate's experience with their own. By choosing an area that is familiar to the candidate, the interviewer allows himself to sidestep problems like constantly having to explain the meaning of acronyms, and fill in missing information. Instead, you get to focus on the design abilities of the candidate. Picking an interview area, which is the intersection between what the interviewer knows and the candidate knows, allows the interview to be a two-way discussion with both sides contributing and both sides learning. This is invaluable for evaluating a design candidate. For example, suppose the interviewer specializes in cloud systems, and the candidate specializes in web systems. In that case, a good design problem might be some sort of combination of those two things. For example, a distributed multimedia system that serves and accepts data over a web interface. The interviewer comes to the interview with a set of design requirements. For example, they might say, well, the system has to be able to serve hundreds of millions of pieces of multimedia, each of them up to 100 megabytes. There could be up to a million users at a time, spread all over the world. Each of the users will have a certain profile. One profile might be they read up to 100 objects a day and they write 10 objects a day. Another profile might be a very big consumer of data who consumes 10,000 objects a day and doesn't write any, and so on. By having an understanding of the design space, the interviewer is more able to effectively guide the interview and get information from the discussion with the candidate. Given these inputs, a good candidate will usually be able to assemble a list of the requirements and their relative importance to one another. This can then guide the rest of the design interview discussion. The next step is to talk about the what and the why of design decisions. For example, will the front end be a web interface where people interact with it through browsers? Will there be some sort of an SDK that allows individual applications to be made, or will there perhaps be an application front end? Is there a single global service, or are there a set of regional services, and why? How are the right servers, both front-end and back-end, identified and connected to? How does the user authenticate to the system, and how do the different system components authenticate to each other? Will the front-end be stateful or stateless? How will durability of the data that's given to the system be ensured, and what will the consistency model be? Will it be possible for a user who retrieves data to get a slightly stale copy of data? Is it possible for some changes to be overwritten in certain race conditions? How will the system be installed and started in the first place? How will it recover from a power outage in a region or globally? How will it be upgraded as improvements are made to the software? How will those upgrades be rolled back? Will there be tracing and auditing available both for debugging and for security purposes? If so, what will the mechanisms be for storing and making that data available? Is there a data retention policy, both for security and privacy purposes? Is there a billing model? And if there isn't, what's the revenue model for this service? And how is that revenue tracked and enforced? Will the system federate with existing authentication services and accounts, or will the user be required to make an account just for this service? These are real problems you have to solve when you're doing large-scale design, and so they're great to discuss in an interview. Nobody understands all of the different components that go into a large system. Typically, it involves dozens of people to design and hundreds or maybe even thousands of people to implement and keep running. So it's not reasonable to expect any person to be able to talk in depth. So that means that one of the key skills for somebody who's designing these systems is the ability to figure out what they need to know and what they don't need to know, and where they have holes in their knowledge so that they can pull in appropriate experts to help them with the design. A side effect of this is that during the design review, the interviewer will get to see the candidate talking about things they understand very well, things they have some idea about, and things that they have no idea about. Ideally, it's important for people to be very clear about where they are in that spectrum as they're proposing solutions and requirements. Otherwise, you can wind up treating a requirement that somebody made out of ignorance as an absolute requirement for the system to function. As each of these questions is addressed by the candidate, it becomes possible to get an idea of all the components in the system and how they interrelate to each other. To express this knowledge, something like a whiteboard or a diagramming or a design tool is invaluable. If you are interviewing in person, this can be on a whiteboard. If you're interviewing remotely, it can be on a shared whiteboard or through some other tool, for example, a diagramming tool that the candidate is familiar with. But if worse comes to worse, it can always revert to some sort of whiteboard with rough diagrams. The diagram can be invaluable for showing that you understand how the components fit together and for discussing relationships between them. That's about all there is to it. Even scratching the surface of a design would take more than 30 minutes, but you can still have a meaningful discussion during the interview. Seeing how a candidate operates under pressure and how much they're able to explain and how logically they approach a problem can be invaluable for making a hire and no hire decision for a design interview. In summary, here's how a design interview works. First, the interviewer does their homework, they get familiar with the qualifications of the candidate, and they pick an area and a problem that they're going to talk about during the design interview. When the interviewer presents the problem, they can describe it as a loose set of needs, but they will need to understand the requirements for that problem or be able to talk intelligently about them off the cuff as the discussion proceeds. Third, the interviewer and the candidate should nail down the requirements for the system and write them down. Fourth, the candidate proposes a design for the system in collaboration with the interviewer. As they put the system together, they talk about the pros and cons and make note of the places where they have pieces that have to be followed up on later. Finally, after the interview, the interviewer writes up notes about the interview and the candidate's performance, and they make a decision, hire, no hire, or they can qualify the hire with insufficient information. And that's the core of a design interview for a software engineer. Thank you for making it this far. If you have experience being interviewed for design positions, or if you have opinions about the information I've provided here, please share it in the comments below. I love reading the comments. I'll respond to them whenever I can, and it would mean a lot to me. Also, if you find this type of career video valuable, please leave a like and think about subscribing to the channel so you can be notified when I release new videos. Thanks again for watching, and keep on pushing forward.